My name is Agai Brahanu. I'm from Asosa University, working research on political representation in regional parliaments of Ethiopia, focusing on the case of Benishangul Gumuz regional parliament. And this project was funded by Global Research Challenge Research Fund and Global Research Network on Parliaments and People. When I do this research, it's not only me. I have my co-researcher, Iyob Sambata. He's also from Asosa University. Let me start my presentation. So as I've said, I'm going to speak about political representation in regional parliaments of Benishangul Gumuz. As we know, democracy and representation are closely intertwined concepts. It's very difficult to think about the one in the absence of the other, that means. And again, ethnic representation is a serious issue in countries with ethnic diversity, particularly where there is feeling of marginalization or where there is quest for fairer representation. It can cause or sometimes exacerbate conflicts. That means the nature of representation matters in a given country. Methodologically, in our research, we employed a mixed approach. We have quantitative data as well as qualitative data we gather through interviews and focus group discussions. Before directly talking about the case of Benishangul Gumuz, a regional state, it's very good to understand the national context within which the case of Benishangul Gumuz regional state is embedded. When we see the national context, Ethiopia as a country first. Ethiopia is an ancient country with a history of over 3,000 years. Of course, the second most populous country in Africa right now. And Ethiopia is a mosaic of diverse ethnic and religious groups. We do have more than 80 ethnic groups living together. That means the peace and the stability of this country depends on how this diversity is handled or how these groups are included or excluded in state apparatus in general and in parliaments in particular. As a result, Ethiopian regimes, particularly Ethiopian regimes of 20th century, attempted to handle this diversity in different ways. For the sake of this presentation, I can roughly divide into two and see how they handled this diversity in this country. So 1991 is a landmark. So pre-1991 have their own pattern, and post-1991 has its own difference from that. So pre-1991 Ethiopian regimes have a tendency of assimilation, and centralization. Of course, their goal was creating a strong Ethiopian state in this part of Africa. But the issue is how we can build a strong Ethiopian state with unity and solidarity. They used assimilation, creating Ethiopia with one language, one religion, and like that. And this has brought exclusion and marginalization to the very diverse religious and ethnic groups in this country. And many scholars argued that this was a failed nation building strategy. And as a result, in 1991, there was a regime change. The regime was overthrown, and this Ethiopian People's Revolutionary Democratic Front assumed political power in Addis Ababa and established Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia with its own constitution, which was drafted in 1990s. And in order to handle this diversity, the post-1991 Ethiopian regime adopted ethnic federalism. And since then, ethnic federalism has become overarching state framework. And the region, the incumbent region, believes that federalism will be a solution to problems of Ethiopia. And as a result, regional states were established based on ethnicity. This region to this ethnic group, that region to that ethnic group, there was region formation based on ethnic lines. And this has created sense of exclusion or marginalization for groups living outside the region in almost all regions. This is in almost all regions in Ethiopia. For instance, in Oromia, we do have millions of non-Oromos, and millions of non-Oromos residing in Oromia are facing this this challenge. So many scholars argued ethnic federalism has only decentralized marginalization and exclusion. As a result, in Ethiopia, currently there is quest for fairer ethnic representation. There are proliferation of regionhood questions, identity questions are at the forefront of local political dynamics in Ethiopia right now. So the case of Benishangul-Gumuz region has to be understood in this wider national context. And Benishangul-Gumuz regional state itself is multi-ethnic, multilingual, multi-religious region, geographically located in western periphery of Ethiopia, bordering with Sudan and South Sudan. It was established by the 1995 Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopian Constitution. When we see ethnic composition of the region, of course, regions have their own constitution in Ethiopian, under Ethiopian ethnic federalism. All regions have their own regional constitution. And the regional constitution has also recognized that there are indigenous people and there are also others. So the indigenous groups identified in Benishangul-Gumuz are five: the Berta, the Gumuz, Shinasha, Mao, and Komo people. Others, sometimes they call non-indigenous, are many, are too many Ethiopian people living in the region: Amhara, Romu, Tagaru, and others. But these, the so-called others, or what sometimes they call non-indigenous, are dominant in national politics, are dominant at the national level. We should understand that issue. The indigenous are, they don't have that much voice in national politics. They are simply indigenous in the Benishangul-Gumuz region. And when we see the population composition, around 57% of the total population of the region is made up of the indigenous people, what we call indigenous. The remaining 43% of the population is the non-indigenous people, according to the 2007 housing and census report. When we see ethnic representation in the parliaments in Benishangul-Gumuz regional state, we do have parliaments at different levels, at three tiers, we can say. We do have elected representatives at Kabale level, we do have elected representatives at Wareda level, we do have also elected representatives at regional level. So there are three tiers. And in our research, we found that in lower tiers of government in Benishangul-Gumuz region, there is better representation of ethnic groups. There is better representation. And as a result, there is no quest for fairer representation. People feel that they are well represented at Kabale level and at Wareda levels. But in the upper tiers, there is feeling of marginalization. And this feeling of marginalization has caused quest for fairer representation among, particularly among the non-indigenous ethnic groups. If we see the regional parliament, for instance, the incumbent regional parliament in Benishangul-Gumuz, it's occupied by one political party and its affiliates, the ruling political party. This similar result of the national parliament, dominated by one single political party and its affiliates. So politics organized along ethnic lines and parliament dominated by a single political party is problematic. It will have some aspects of exclusion and marginalization. As a result, some groups are feeling that they are not well represented in the regional parliament as well as town parliaments. Despite this feeling, this system was there for around 25, 26 years due to two reasons. The first reason is weak or absence of competitive multi-party election in the Nshangulkums as well as the whole Ethiopia. There is weak or there is no even competitive multi-party election. As I have said, if you go and see the parliament in the Nshangulkums, it's occupied by a single political party and its affiliates. So parliamentary seats are not well distributed among the groups in society. And even candidate approval matters. Once their candidacy is approved, they will become a parliamentarian because there is no competitive election in the region. This cannot and of course should not continue due to increasing role of social media activism currently. And there is also again upsurge of new wave ethnic nationalists. This increasing role of social media activism and upsurge of new wave ethnic nationalism, they complement each other, they feed each other, they work together. And due to this, such system cannot continue or people will completely resist such things. And such things should all, of course, change. And parliament should look like at least the demography of the people, the demography of the region, I mean. When we see what are the problems, what are the challenges to ensure political representation in BGRS, there are complicated issues, of course. There are three issues complicating this issue, this problem. The first one is this indigenous, non-indigenous conundrum has its own problem. And the other one is, I already mentioned, upsurge of new wave ethnic nationalism, complemented with social media activism has also complicated the problem. And demographic change is another problem. Demographic change. The demography of the region is slightly changing. The indigenous groups are, what I mean by demographic change, the indigenous groups entitled with self-rule rights extending up to secession according to the Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopian Constitution are becoming minorities in their localities. Because the so-called non-indigenous are dominant at national level and the population movement is there, their number is becoming lower and lower and lower. So they are becoming minorities. They cannot win. If we are saying let election determine the issue, then the so-called indigenous ethnic groups cannot win election because politics is arranged along ethnic lines and their population number is very low compared with the other groups. This has complicated the issue of representation in the region. And the problem is here, among the non-indigenous ethnic groups, there is increasing quest for fairer representation. They are feeling that as marginalized, as excluded from the regional political platform. But among the indigenous groups on the other hand, there is feeling of losing their self-rule rights in their localities. The indigenous groups, they want to preserve the status quo. And the others want to change that. There is contending interest there. In our research, we are arguing that these contending quests should be balanced and addressed well by the concerned body. The government, as well as the non-government stakeholders, should address this issue. How these issues can be solved? The first one is ensuring representation is a must for peace and stability of the region as well as the country. How we can ensure this? First, adopting proportional representation electoral system might be helpful. Second, conducting competitive multi-party election is a must. Conducting competitive multi-party election is a must in this region as well as in the country. But the issue here is, we want to underline is, precautionary measures should be taken so that ensuring fairer representation should not override self-rule rights of the indigenous groups. Because indigenous groups, their rights have to be respected. They must have a voice in the parliament and other state apparatus. So adopting proportional electoral system, creating favorable conditions for competitive multi-party election alone is not enough. A special attention should be paid to the indigenous groups, the indigenous groups. And the other issue might be increasing the number of regional parliamentary seats. Yes, the regional parliament has around 99 parliamentary seats. But if we see the ethnic cleavage, the religious cleavage, the age categories, if all this section of society have to be represented well, the regional parliamentary seats can be increased, and that's possible to do. And the regional parliament office is aware of this, and I think they are working over it. Of course, this needs constitutional amendment. To conclude, the current region, or whoever rules the country, whoever rules Ethiopia, must balance, must handle this diversity effectively. In the case of Benishangul Gumuz region, the quest of fairer representation among the non-indigenous groups and self-rule rights of indigenous groups in the region have to be balanced. Inability to balance these contending quests will negatively influence Ethiopia's attempt of deepening democracy. Because if peace cannot prevail, if stability is not there, then we cannot talk about democracy. So to ensure peace and stability, handling diversity in a very planned, strategic manner that suits all concerned parties is very important, and the region should undertake measures in that manner. And I have done with my presentation, and I thank you.